push people in silent shroud of snow. I am a rock, I am an island. I build walls in fortress deep and mighty that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I am a rock. I am an island. Don't talk of love. The slumber of feelings that I've died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I am a rock, I am an island. I have my books and my poetry to protect me. Feels no pain, and an island never cries. Don't matter what you look like, don't matter what you wear.
Going through the motions, learning how to pretend that everything is perfect. And I've been sinking, drowning, but I'm silent, yet everyone thinks I'm afloat. And I've been running through mazes. Maybe it's just a phase, but regardless, I am flipping the pages. I've been going through changes, but I swear I'm the same.
Taking away the moments that make up a dull day, flittering waste the moment of an offhand way, kicking around the piece of the ground in your hometown, waiting for someone or something to show you the way. No one told you when to run. You missed the starting guns. You run and you run to catch up to the sun, but it's sinking.
The air begins to feel a little thin as I start the car and I begin to add the miles piled up behind me, and I barely feel a smile deep inside me. I begin to envy the headlights driving south as I cracked the door so I could just fall out. But then I remembered when you packed my car, you reached in the back and buckled up your heart for me to drive away with. And I began to understand why God died.
And ready, I wait without worry to count all the stars that she bears. One star for loving, one star for memories, and one star for melancholy. One star for longing, and one star for poetry, and one star for Ma, mother.
Viola Spolin was a director and actress who focused on self-awareness and created theater games to influence that. And she strongly believed that anyone could be an actor and anyone could learn how to. Lee Strasberg was a theatrical teacher that taught methods in which people took personal experiences to apply for emotional effect in a scene. I personally have used these methods in acting in order to tap into my emotions to further make my methods realistic.
I was charged with studying the Meisner technique. It was developed by Stanford Meisner, who developed his technique because of Strasberg. Meisner taught his students to delve into an imagined situation that will generate real emotions.
Una Hagen was an actor, teacher, and an author who taught a technique called substitution, which was later called transference, which focused on specifics, authenticity, and how to not get lost in their character. I used this method as a way to find myself in my characters, as a way to develop them.
After studying under Stanislavski in the Moscow School of Art and Theater in the early 1900s, Mikhail Alexandrovich Chekhov developed a method of his own. It focused on the psychophysical, using your body, and practicing certain exercises, and then using those exercises to conjure up emotion within yourself and in your acting.
Stella Adler was an American actor and acting teacher who was greatly affected by Konstantin Stanislavski, and her acting method was analyze the text or the script to show some respect to director and playwrights, and she also stressed that actors' action must come from their life, must come from their honest reflect from their life.
Practical aesthetic technique is developed by David Mamet, and he created this technique and inspired by Meisner. So this technique is about having the actors be confident with like their decisions when it comes to play.
With Stanislavski's technique, he was the birthing technique of the 20th century and was taught to most actors and actresses on Broadway and in movies. Also, his technique was the starting point for all of my colleagues' techniques they talked about.
You can have your dream and I can have mine. There is a way. Do you remember my telling you he had written complaining of pain about his heart? He said it was nothing serious, but I've let it be known. I went to see our old family doctor, and I told him about Ezra's letter. I pretended to be dreadfully worried until I got him worried too. He's the town's worst old gossip, and I'm sure everyone knows about Ezra's weak heart by this time. If he dies suddenly now, no one will think was anything but heart failure. I've been reading a book in Father's medical library, and I saw it there one day, a few weeks ago, as if some fate forced me to see it. I've written something here. I want you to get it for me. You sail to Boston tomorrow to wait for cargo? Get this at some druggist down there by the waterfront. The minute you reach there, you can make up a story about a sick dog in your ship. As soon as you get it, mail it to me. Here. Then, you must wait until you hear from me, or I come to you afterward. He's taking his medicine. I'll give him his medicine. I planned it carefully.
Ever since I went to sea and was on my own and found out what hard work for a little pay was and what it felt like to be broke and starve and camp on the park benches because I had no place to sleep, I've tried to make my allowances. You have to make allowances in this damned family or go nuts. I've tried to make my allowances when I remember all the stuff that I pulled. All the rotten stuff. But, Papa, have you tried to pardon your shame? And don't think I'll let you get away with it. I won't go to any damned State Farm to just save you a few lost dollars to buy bum properly with. You stinking old miser.
Okay, here goes. The reason I'm writing Angie Atkinson is because I don't think I can ever stop writing letters, particularly to girls. As I've told you before, in some ways I feel most alive when I'm in a corner, writing things down. I pick up a pen and the world just seems to take shape around me. I love to write. I love writing my parents because then I become the ideal son. I love writing essays for English class because then for a while I'm a true scholar. I love writing letters to the newspaper, notes to friends, Christmas cards, anything that involves putting a pen to paper. I love writing you. You most of all. I feel like a true lover when I'm writing you. I always have. This letter, which I'm writing with my own pen and my own penmanship with my own hand, it's a present of myself to you. There's no copy of it, though I suppose I could use a carbon, and it's not typewritten, though I've learned how to type, And it's not a phone call which is dead as soon as it's over. No, this is just me giving myself to you across a distance, the way I want to be to you. And you can tear me up and throw me out, or you can keep me and read me. Today, tomorrow, any day you want until you die.
And when that mockingbird won't sing, Mama's gonna buy you a diamond ring. Oh, child, you are a pretty one. Your eyes are wondrous, child. Simply wondrous. You know, Dr. Harris told your papa that you ought to be the prettiest little baby he's ever seen. So fat and sassy, your papa says. Oh, he believes you're bound to eat us out of the house and home as healthy as you are. My word, the amount that must be going on inside that tiny little head of yours. It's so much to do for such a little thing. All that breathing and heart beating and digesting and mess making. I wonder at times why it all must be so complicated. Why we can't go on digesting and mess making till we're past the age of caring anymore about where we live or how much money it's gonna cost your poor papa to pay for all of this babying. You see that tree on there? The tiny one? Your father planted that today for you, Elizabeth. And it's got good Indiana soil under it, child. A rich, dark earth. And when spring comes, I'm gonna hollow out some eggshells and I'll paint them prettier than the sky for you, Elizabeth. Oh, you won't be able to keep your eyes off of it. Prettier than the sky, Elizabeth.
Report.
And here we go with the news. Take it away, Thurston.
Well, folks, in today's news, we have the winner of the Tuna Junior High American Heritage Essay Contest for this year. And this year's winner is Connie Carp. She's the daughter of W.H. and Vera Carp here in Tuna. And second place goes to Jimbo Beaumont for Living with Radiation. And third place goes to Valletta Posey for her essay titled The Other Side of Bigotry. Well, Arliss, with essays like this, I don't know how they picked the winner.
I don't either. But it should make the citizens of Tuna proud to know that we're still producing well-educated students who know what America is all about.
They do.
They do, they do, they do.
I always thought they did a fine
job. Oh, thank you, Ron. Oh, excuse me, Thurston. Oh,
go right ahead.
Oh, I have bad news for the greater Tuna area. Former County Judge Roscoe Buckner died at his home yesterday. He had suffered a severe stroke. Buckner, who was a judge of the greater Tuna area for 47 years, and who hung more people in the 30s than any other active judge, had a history of heart trouble. Now the body will lie in state at Hubert Funeral Home starting today at 12 noon. And what Sir Hubert says, if you come before noon, you're gonna have to wait because the body won't be ready till noon.
Well, folks, I tell you, that's some bad news.
It is.
It is.
It is. It is. Now on the art scene, the on again, off again auditions for the Tuna Little Theater production of My Fair Lady are on again. Now they've been called off due to a lack of budget, but Joe Bob Lipsey, who's the director of the show this year, and who is a recent graduate of Southwest Texas Eastern A&I State University, said he found a way to go ahead with the production by using sets and costumes of last year's show of South Pacific. And according to Joe Bob, this is going to be the first production ever of My Fair Lady set in Polynesia.
Well, Arliss, that's something that's liable to put us on the map.
On and on.
On it. They'll find us.
So Joe Bob says, get on your Hawaiian shirts and your grass skirts and your coconuts and get on out there to that Coweta Baptist Church at 8:30 Thursday night and audition for My Fair Lady. And Joe Bob wants to integrate the cast this year, so if you know of any African or Mexican American actors or actresses,
Have them come on out and try out for the chorus.
That's right. Come on out.
Come on out.
Come on out. You never know. You might just get a part.
You might. You might. Well, Thurston, you got that farm report?
Oh, yeah, I got that farm report. Well, folks, it's going to be an incomplete farm report because everything's not in just yet. But I got beef up, pork down, and chicken vacillating, and don't know that much about cell bellies. But I do know it's time for a word from our sponsor, D.D. Snavely of D.D.'s Used Weapons. And here's D.D. now to tell us all about it. D.D.?
Does the high cost of security have you blue? Come on down to our store and browse through a complete selection of used guns and knives, or find what you need in our Mason to your gas department. Now, we understand that many people are hesitant to buy used weapons, but all of D.D.'s weapons are absolutely guaranteed to kill. Now, if you find a weapon here that won't kill, you just bring it on back, and we'll give you something that will. As a matter of fact, it's on our guarantee. If D.D.'s can't kill it, it's immortal.
Well, thank you, D.D. It's always a pleasure to have D.D. here with us. Thank you, D.D.
Thank you, Ronnie. This just in, a UFO, that is an unidentified flying object, has been spotted by R.R. Snavely over Lake Mobet. R.R. says it looks like a gigantic hovering chalupa without the guacamole. Well, that's what it says.
It does.
It does, it does. And from our world news desk, peace talks fail. Attack is imminent. Well, that's all the news we got for you, but stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
Because we got Leonard on the line coming up in
Thank you, Rodney. Just got a note here for you. Forgot to turn on the power switch. You're not on the air.
Superior Donuts is set in the modern-day uptown of Chicago. It depicts the unexpected friendship between Arthur, a down-and-out donut shop owner, and Franco, his enthusiastic employee. Franco brings a fresh perspective and wants to update the place, while the reluctant Arthur struggles with changing the shop and changing his ways. A comedy with heart and a bit of grit, Superior Donuts introduces us to a wide range of neighborhood dwellers and unapologetically hits on economic, racial, and generational issues. I am Madison Higdon, and I was the stage manager of Superior Donuts, which was performed April 18th here in the Keim Center. Now you'll see a scene performed between two characters, Randy and Arthur, performed by Kayla Gunn and Alex Miller.
Wow, you really know your donut history.
And that's just the American side of the story. The French have a donut they call pain de nun, which means nun's fart. The story is a young nun was working in an abbey, and she was working in the kitchen one day when she suddenly emitted flatus. The other nuns laughed at her, and she was so startled she dropped a ball of dough in a bubbling cauldron and invented the donut.
Huh.
The French, right?
Emitted flatus.
Eat that. A little overdone.
Caught him cooking, huh?
He's been mixing the dough. He's been mixing the dough for a couple days now, but today's his first day on the fryer.
Big day?
Yeah. You want a donut?
What's good today?
It's all the same. It's not the same as everything else, just the same as it always is.
Well, what's your favorite?
Well, I don't eat them so often. Cinnamon is the freshest. It's the most fresh of the doughs, the most recent of the doughs I made, so the cinnamon is the freshest.
I guess I'll have a cinnamon. Frank will make this?
Oh no, he's a long way from edible.
You make your dough from scratch?
Every evening, by hand.
I bet not very many people do that anymore.
Oh, it's a dying art.
Yo, damn it, mother of a peanut oil gets hot!
You want some coffee?
Sure.
That was a game.
What?
The Blackhawks game.
Oh. Right. I didn't go. to my brother, Mike.
That's too bad.
Yeah.
That's too bad.
Hey.
I better go check on Franco.
What are you doing back here? I can't
do this, man. I've been out of here.
You're doing fine. You're doing fine.
Where's James?
On a call with his wife. A convention coming up. Star Trek convention.
Convention? Wow.
Yeah, they get all dressed up like the characters from the show.
James dresses up?
Yeah, the pointy ears, the whole shebang.
Or whatever gets you through the night, right?
Right. Oh, he's a total nerd and a freaking idiot. But it's sweet that he and his wife do those things together. You know? No matter what losers they are, at least they got each other. My whole family's guys, right? All of them cops. My dad was a cop, 6 of my 7 brothers were cops. So all my life it's been cops and sports and whiskey and all that good old Irish shit. And I love it, you know? It's my home. It's who I am. But, you know, I always wish I didn't always have to be in the club. I thought, wouldn't it be nice if I could just be who I wanted to be and someone could come and join in with me for a change?
Yeah.
I don't know.
No, I... Yeah.
This is
and
really...
I was gonna say that... sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was just gonna say good coffee.
It is good.
Yes.
I mean, is it good?
So you were saying.
I don't remember.